The raid at Kabanachan, also known as the Great Raid, was a rescue of Allied prisoners of war and civilians from a Japanese camp near Kabanachan City, in the Philippines. On January 30, 1945, during World War II, United States Army Rangers, Alamo Scouts, and Filipino guerrillas liberated more than 500 from the POW camp. After the surrender of tens of thousands of American troops during the Battle of Bataan, many were sent to a Kabanachan prison camp following the Bataan Death March. The Japanese transferred most of the prisoners to other areas, leaving just over 500 American and other Allied POWs and civilians in the prison, facing brutal conditions including disease, torture, and malnourishment. The prisoners feared they would all be executed as General Douglas MacArthur and his American forces returned to Luzon. In late January 1945, a plan was developed by 6th Army leaders and Filipino guerrillas to send a small force to rescue the prisoners. A group of over 100 rangers and scouts and several hundred guerrillas traveled 30 miles behind Japanese lines to reach the camp. In a nighttime raid, under the cover of darkness and a distraction by a P-61 Black Widow, the group surprised the Japanese forces in and around the camp. Hundreds of Japanese troops were killed in the 30-minute coordinated attack. The Americans suffered minimal casualties. The rangers, scouts, and guerrillas escorted the POWs back to American lines. The rescue allowed the prisoners to tell of the death march and prison camp atrocities, which sparked a new rush of resolve for the war against Japan. The rescuers were awarded commendations by MacArthur, and were also recognized by President Franklin D. Roosevelt. A memorial now sits on the site of the former camp, and the events of the raid have been depicted in several films. Background. After the United States was attacked at Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941 by Japanese forces, it entered World War II to join the Allied forces in the fight against the Axis powers. American forces led by General Douglas MacArthur, already stationed in the Philippines as a deterrent against a Japanese invasion of the islands, were attacked by the Japanese hours after Pearl Harbor. On March 12, 1942, General MacArthur and a few select officers, on the orders of President Franklin D. Roosevelt, left the American forces, promising to return with reinforcements. The 72,000 soldiers of the United States Army forces in the Far East, fighting with outdated weapons, lacking supplies, and stricken with disease and malnourishment, eventually surrendered to the Japanese on April 9, 1942. The Japanese had initially planned for only 10,000 minus 25,000 American and Filipino prisoners of war, although they had organized two hospitals, ample food, and guards for this estimate. They were overwhelmed with over 72,000 prisoners. By the end of the 60-mile march, only 52,000 prisoners reached Camp O'Donnell, with an estimated 20,000 having died from illness, hunger, torture, or murder. Later, with the closure of Camp O'Donnell, most of the imprisoned soldiers were transferred to the Kabanachan prison camp to join the POWs from the Battle of Corregidor. In 1944, when the United States landed on the Philippines to recapture it, orders had been sent out by the Japanese high command to kill the POWs in order to avoid them being rescued by liberating forces. One method of the execution was to round the prisoners up in one location, pour gasoline over them, and then burn them alive. After hearing the accounts of the survivors from the massacre at the Puerto Princesa prison camp, the liberating forces feared the safety of the POWs being held in the country were at jeopardy. They decided to launch a series of rescue operations to save the surviving POWs on the islands. POW Camp. The Kabanachan prison camp was named after the nearby city of 50,000 people. The camp had first been used as an American Department of Agriculture station and then a training camp for the Filipino Army. When the Japanese invaded the Philippines, they used the camp to house American POWs. It was one of three camps in the Kabanachan area and was designated for holding sick detainees. Occupying more than 25 acres, the rectangular-shaped camp was 800 yards deep by 600 yards across, divided by a road that ran through its center. One side of the camp housed Japanese guards, while the other included bamboo barracks for the prisoners as well as a section for a hospital. Nicknamed the Zero Ward, the hospital housed the sickliest prisoners as they waited to die from diseases such as dysentery and malaria. 8-foot-high barbed wire fences surrounded the camp, in addition to multiple pillbox bunkers and 4-story guard towers. At its peak, the camp held 8,000 American soldiers, making it the largest POW camp in the Philippines. This number dropped significantly as able-bodied soldiers were shipped to other areas in the Philippines, Japan, Japanese-occupied Taiwan, and Manchukuo to work in slave labor camps. Geneva Convention provisions were ignored as POWs transported out of the camp were forced to work in factories to build Japanese weaponry, unload ships, and repair airfields. Japan had not ratified the Geneva Treaty at the time and were thus not bound by those conventions. The imprisoned soldiers received 2 meals a day of steamed rice, occasionally accompanied by fruit, soup, or meat, to supplement their diet. Prisoners were able to smuggle food and supplies hidden in their underwear into the camp during Japanese-approved trips to Kabanachan, to prevent extra food, jewelry, diaries, and other valuables from being confiscated. Items were hidden in clothing, latrines, or were buried before scheduled inspections. Prisoners collected food using a variety of methods, including stealing, bribing guards, planting gardens, and killing animals which entered the camp, such as mice, snakes, ducks, and stray dogs. The Filipino underground collected thousands of quinine tablets to smuggle into the camp to treat malaria, saving hundreds of lives. When the Japanese had an American radio technician fix their radios, he would steal parts, allowing the prisoners to have several radios to listen to newscasts of the war efforts outside the camp. One group of Corregidor prisoners, before first entering the camp, had each hidden a piece of a radio under their clothing, to later be reassembled into a working device. The radios were able to pick up a San Francisco-based radio station, allowing the POWs to hear about the status of war outside the gates of the prison. A smuggled camera was used to document the camp's living conditions. Prisoners also constructed weapons and smuggled ammunition into the camp for the possibility of securing a handgun. Multiple escape attempts were made throughout the history of the prison camp, but the majority ended in failure. In one attempt, 4 soldiers were recaptured by the Japanese. The guards forced all prisoners to watch as the 4 soldiers were beaten, forced to dig their own graves, and then executed. Shortly thereafter, the guards put up signs declaring that if other escape attempts were made, 10 prisoners would be executed for every escapee. Prisoners' living quarters were then divided into groups of 10, which motivated the POWs to keep a close eye on others to prevent him from making escape attempts. The Japanese permitted the POWs to build septic systems and irrigation ditches throughout the prisoner side of the camp. An on-site commissary was available to sell items such as bananas, eggs, coffee, notebooks, and cigarettes. Recreational activities allowed for baseball, horseshoes, and ping-pong matches. In addition, a 3,000-book library was allowed, and films were shown occasionally. A bulldog was kept by the prisoners, and served as a mascot for the camp. Each year around Christmas, the Japanese guards gave permission for the Red Cross to donate a small box to each of the prisoners, containing items such as corned beef, instant coffee, and tobacco. Prisoners were also able to send postcards to relatives, although they were censored by the guards. As American forces continued to approach Luzon, the Japanese Imperial High Command ordered that all able-bodied POWs be transported to Japan. From the Kabanachan camp, over 1,600 soldiers were removed in October 1944, leaving over 500 sick, WIC, or disabled POWs. On January 6, 1945, all of the guards withdrew from the Kabanichan camp, leaving the POWs alone. The guards had previously told prisoner leaders that they should not attempt to escape, else suffer the consequence of being killed. When the guards left, the prisoners heeded the threat, fearing that the Japanese were waiting near the camp and would use the attempted escape as an excuse to execute the Mao. Instead, the prisoners went to the guard side of the camp and ransacked the Japanese buildings for supplies and large amounts of food. Prisoners were alone for several weeks, except when retreating Japanese forces would periodically stay in the camp. The soldiers mainly ignored the POWs, except to ask for food. Although aware of the consequences, the prisoners sent a small group outside the prison's gates to bring in two carabaos to slaughter. The meat from the animals, along with the food secured from the Japanese side of the camp, helped many of the POWs to regain their strength, weight, and stamina. In mid-January, a large group of Japanese troops entered the camp and returned the prisoners to their side of the camp. The prisoners, fueled by rumors, speculated that they would soon be executed by the Japanese. Planning and preparation. On October 20, 1944, General Douglas MacArthur's forces landed on Leyte, paving the way for the liberation of the Philippines. Several months later, as the Americans consolidated their forces to prepare for the main invasion of Luzon, nearly 150 Americans were executed by their Japanese captors on December 14, 1944 at the Puerto Princesa prison camp on the island of Palawan. These Americans were herded into air raid shelters, sealed in, doused with gasoline, and burned alive. One of the survivors, PFC Eugene Nielsen, recounted his tale to U.S. Army intelligence on January 7, 1945. 2 days later, MacArthur's forces landed on Luzon and began a rapid advance towards the capital, Manila. Major Bob Lapham, the American USAFFE senior guerrilla chief, and another guerrilla leader, Juan Pajota, had considered freeing the prisoners within the camp but feared logistical issues with hiding and caring for the prisoners. An earlier plan had been proposed by Lieutenant Colonel Bernard Anderson, leader of the guerrillas near the camp. He suggested that the guerrillas would secure the prisoners, escort them 50 miles to Debu Bay, and transport them using 30 submarines. The plan was denied approval as MacArthur feared the Japanese would catch up with the fleeing prisoners and kill them all. In addition, the Navy did not have the required submarines, especially with MacArthur's upcoming invasion of Luzon. On January 26, 1945, Lapham traveled from his location near the prison camp to 6th Army headquarters, 30 miles away. He proposed to Lieutenant General Walter Kruger's intelligence chief Colonel Horton White that a rescue attempt be made to liberate the estimated 500 POWs at the Kabanichan prison camp before the Japanese possibly killed them all. Lapham estimated Japanese forces to include 100 to 300 soldiers within the camp, 1,000 across the Kabu River northeast of the camp, and possibly around 5,000 within Kabanichan City. Pictures of the camp were also available, as planes had taken surveillance images as recently as January 19. White estimated that the First Corps would not reach Kabanichan City until January 31 or February 1, and that if any rescue attempt were to be made, it would have to be on January 29. White reported the details to Kruger, who gave the order for the rescue attempt. White gathered Lt. Col. Henry Mucci, leader of the 6th Ranger Battalion, and three lieutenants from the Alamo Scouts, the special reconnaissance unit attached to his 6th Army, for a briefing on their mission to raid Kabanichan and rescue the POWs. The group developed a plan to rescue the prisoners. 14 scouts, made up of two teams, would leave 24 hours ahead of the main force to survey the camp. The main force would consist of 90 Rangers from C Company and 30 from F Company, who would march 30 miles behind Japanese lines, surround the camp, kill the guards, and rescue and escort the prisoners back to American lines. The Americans would join up with 80 Filipino guerrillas, who would serve as guides and help in the rescue attempt. The initial plan was to attack the camp at 17:30 PST on January 29. On the evening of January 27, the Rangers studied air reconnaissance photos and listened to guerrilla intelligence on the prison camp. The two five-man teams of Alamo Scouts, led by 1st LTS, William Nellist and Thomas Roundsable, left Gimbra at 1900 and infiltrated behind enemy lines for the long trek to attempt a reconnaissance of the prison camp. Each scout was armed with a 45 pistol, three hand grenades, a rifle or M1 carbine, a knife, and extra ammunition. The next morning, the scouts linked up with several Filipino guerrilla units at the village of Platra, 2 miles north of the camp. The Rangers were armed with assorted Thompson submachine guns, SPARs, M1 Garand rifles, pistols, grenades, knives, extra ammunition, as well as a few bazookas. Four combat photographers from a unit of the 832nd Signal Service Battalion volunteered to accompany the scouts and rangers to record the rescue. After Mucci suggested the idea of documenting the raid, each photographer was armed with a pistol. Despite Geneva Convention restrictions on armed medical personnel, Surgeon Captain Jimmy Fisher and his medics each carried pistols and carbines. To maintain a link between the raiding group and army command, a radio outpost was established outside of Gimba. The force had two radios, but their use was only approved in asking for aircraft support if they ran into large Japanese forces or if there were last-minute changes to the raid behind enemy lines. Shortly after 500 on January 28, Mucci and a reinforced company of 121 Rangers under Captain Robert Prince drove 60 miles to Gimba, before slipping through Japanese lines at just after 1400. Guided by Filipino guerrillas, the Rangers hiked through open grasslands to avoid enemy patrols in villages along the Rangers' route. Other guerrillas assisted in muzzling dogs and putting chickens in cages to prevent the Japanese from hearing the traveling group. At one point, the Rangers narrowly avoided a Japanese tank on the national highway by following a ravine that ran under the road. The group reached Balinkarin, a barrio 5 miles north of the camp, the following morning. Mucci linked up with scouts Nellist and Roundsable to go over the camp reconnaissance from the previous night. The scouts revealed that the terrain around the camp was flat, which would leave the force exposed before the raid. Mucci also met with USAFFE guerrilla captain Juan Pajota and his 200 men, whose intimate knowledge of enemy activity, the locals, and the terrain proved crucial. Upon learning that Mucci wanted to push through with the attack that evening, Pajota resisted, insisting that it would be suicide. He revealed that the guerrillas had been watching an estimated 1,000 Japanese soldiers camped out across the Kabu River just a few hundred yards from the prison. Pajota also confirmed reports that as many as 7,000 enemy troops were deployed around Kabanachan City, located several miles away. With the invading American forces from the southwest, a Japanese division was withdrawing to the north on a road close to the camp. He recommended waiting for the division to pass so that the force would face minimal opposition. After consolidating information from Pajota and the Alamo scouts about heavy enemy activity in the camp area, Mucci agreed to postpone the raid for 24 hours, and alerted the 6th Army headquarters to the development by radio. He directed the scouts to return to the camp and gain additional intelligence, especially on the strength of the guards and the exact location of the captive soldiers. The Rangers withdrew to Platra, a barrio 2.5 miles south of Balinkarin.